Hi there, physics fans. Welcome to another visit to my den, where I want to tell you about another fascinating building block of matter. I'm talking about the leptons. The word lepton comes from the Greek word leptos, which means small or light. While all subatomic particles are far removed from people's day-to-day experience, at least one of the leptons affects us every day. Let's learn more about them in today's episode of Subatomic Stories. The leptons are generally much lighter than the quarks. There are two classes of leptons, the top row, which experience two of the subatomic forces, and the bottom row, which experiences only one. Since they're different in this way, I'm going to make two videos about them. This video will talk about the top row, which have electric charge and are governed by the forces of electromagnetism. There are three charged leptons, all with the same charge as the electron. These leptons are called the electron, the muon, and the tau lepton. Basically, you can think of them as cousin particles of increasing mass. The muon is about 207 times heavier than the electron, while the tau lepton is about 3,500 times heavier than the electron. The muon and tau lepton are unstable. The muon decays in about 2 microseconds, and the tau lepton decays in 0.3 trillionths of a second. So you need good equipment to measure them. The electron is the most familiar subatomic particle. It is responsible for atoms emitting light and all of chemistry. Our technological world depends on it. To understand its behavior requires, you know, something about quantum mechanics. Two of my longer videos cover some of these topics, and I put links to them in the description. The muon is ephemeral, but it is super important. The muon acts like a spinning electric charge, and when you put a spinning charge in a magnetic field, it will precess like a top. Scientists have calculated the rate at which the muon will precess to 12 digits of accuracy, and they've measured it about as well as that. The calculation and the measurement disagree enough to be exciting. If a more precise measurement supports this discrepancy, it will be a huge discovery. And guess where that measurement will occur? At my own Fermilab with the G-2 experiment. I made a long video about the G-2 experiment, and I put the link in the description. If you're interested in what could well be the biggest physics discovery of the decade, take a look. It's hard to know when the G-2 researchers will make their announcement, but it's likely to be in under a year, maybe sooner. I certainly hope sooner. So that's a quick introduction to the charged leptons. There's more to learn, of course. There's always more to learn. But it's time to move on. In our next episode, I want to tell you about the bottom row, the neutrinos. They have some very mind-blowing properties. See you soon. So this is the part of the episode where I answer your questions. So, let's get started. My YouTube channel likes my book, History of the Vikings, and asks, wait, were the Vikings particle physicists too? Only the very smart and attractive ones. Leif Erikson asks, are you sure about that? Yes. Jerry Miller notes that the force is strong in the quarks. Of course the force is strong in quarks. Why do you think lightsabers are red, blue, and green, huh? On second thought, never mind. This isn't the answer you're looking for. Oheng75 says, your jokes are so quirky and funny. Thank you, thank you. I'm here all week. Be sure to tip the waitstaff. Okay, on a more serious note, Mozib Boss asks, do quarks decay? That's a very, very good question. Quarks only decay via one force, the weak force. For instance, the top quark can emit a particle called the W boson. The W boson is a particle of the weak force. When it emits a W boson, it can transform itself into a bottom quark. Similarly, a bottom quark can transform into a charm can transform into a strange. The only quark that doesn't decay is the up quark, and we'll learn a little bit more about that when we have the episode on the weak force. Debrata Kalita asks about the quantization of charge. How can quarks have a fractional charge? To say a charge is quantized simply means that it comes in discrete lumps. Now, in the old days, we thought that the electron was the smallest charge, so that it had a charge of minus one, and that made perfectly good sense. However, when quarks were discovered, we realized that there were charges smaller than that. For instance, the down quark has a charge of -1/3. So you could have just as easily changed your definition of charge and said the down quark had a charge of -1. In that case, the electron would have a charge of -3. So it's still not a problem. The charge is quantized. It just is quantized in smaller allotments than you would think if you use the electron as your base charge. Good question. Ricky101 asks, do quarks have mass? That's a great question. I didn't talk about the mass of the quarks in my quark video, but there's actually a huge range of masses in quarks. In units where the mass of the proton is 1,000, the mass of the up and down quarks are more in the range of 2 to 3 to 4, whereas the top quark has a mass of 172,000, which is a huge amount of mass. Why do the various quarks have different masses? We actually don't know the answer to that. The mass of the quarks is given by the Higgs boson, and we'll talk about that in an upcoming episode. Tootle asks, what kind of matter can be built with quarks? They know that the proton, the neutron, is 3 quarks, but what about 2 quarks and 4 quarks? What about other ones? In my previous video, I talked about how quarks can come grouped in 3s. And when they come grouped in 3s, that's a class of particles called the baryon. The most familiar baryons are the proton and the neutron. However, there are other types of particles called mesons, which are a quark and antimatter quark pair. So those are the two most common ways in which quarks can be combined. The 3 quarks in the baryons and the matter-antimatter pair of quarks in the mesons. But they're not the only ways that quarks can combine. For instance, even in the original paper, things like 2 quarks and 2 antimatter quarks could combine. Another thing is what we call a pentaquark, which is actually 4 quarks and an antimatter quark. Those have been observed. Other predictions are things called hexaquarks, which are 6 quarks all together. Those haven't been seen. So there are many ways in which quarks have been predicted to combine and make known particles. But the big ones, the most common ones, are the baryons and the mesons. The other types, so many of them have been seen, and we're looking for others. Siddharth Makanar asks, are the protons and neutrons only made of quarks, or is there anything else? Well, that's actually very interesting. In the simplest model, we say that the proton and the neutron are made of 3 quarks. However, that's not the entire truth. Actually, if you really look at a proton carefully, you see that it does have those 3 quarks, but there's also a bath of particles called gluons, which govern the strong force. And even more confusingly, the energy in the gluons can make, for a very short amount of time, matter and antimatter quarks, which are appearing and disappearing. So if you really look at a proton in high, careful technical detail, you see the 3 known quarks, you see gluons, you see matter and antimatter quarks appearing and disappearing. It's a total complicated mess, and people spend their careers studying the details of how the energy and matter and charge and spin is all combined inside things like the proton, the neutron, and other particles that we've seen. Dolphin Whale asks, can an electron and a quark annihilate? And I don't know if this is a dumb question. That's not a dumb question at all, but it turns out the answer is no. The only things that can annihilate when you have matter and antimatter particles is when they're the same. So a quark and an antimatter quark can annihilate, a electron and an antimatter electron can annihilate, but a quark cannot annihilate an antimatter electron, nor can an electron annihilate an antimatter quark. Just can't happen. Okay, so that's all the time we have for questions today. I hope you like the episode. If you do, please like it. Subscribe to the channel and share us on social media. In our next episode, we will talk about neutrinos, which is one of the most fascinating subatomic particles of all, one of the most interesting topics in all of physics. And I'm excited to learn more about it, and hope you are too, because even at home, physics is everything.